at the Pentecostals of Lee Road, to all the grandparents, aunts, uncles, brothers, and sisters here today for the baby dedication service. We want to welcome you into the sanctuary on Highway 40. Amen. If you're a guest with us, we do have First Impression team members that have a lanyard around their neck with a tag that can instruct you where the restrooms are, or if you need to go out during the service, there'll be a First Impression team member at the door, and then see one of them if you have need of something. But it's good to be in the house of the Lord. The house is full. Amen. We want you to enjoy the service today to our grandparents and our parents. Again, thank you for giving us the honor today of dedicating your child and your grandchildren unto the Lord, because the children are a gift from God. And today I pray that you will be challenged by this service as a parent to raise up your child in the fear of God. Amen. At this time in the Pentecostal Lee Road, I'd like to welcome you to the front for a time of worship and sing with them and worship the Lord this morning. God bless you.
Come on, put your hands together in the house. Is Jesus glorious?
Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus.
Sing it.
Your presence is heaven to me.
Oh, it's heaven, Lord. Oh, yeah.
Treasure of my heart and of my soul.
Jesus,
your presence. that I see you face to face. Nothing in this world could satisfy.
Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry.
Sing that to him again.
Nothing in this world could satisfy. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. I can say with certainty, with the utmost assurity, that the presence of the Lord is here, because His Word says that God inhabits the praises of His people. And can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise today? The name that is above every other name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What you feel right now is the presence of the Lord. He's softening our hearts. He's opening our minds. He's preparing us for the rest of this service today. God bless you. Thank you for your response to worship. You may be seated. Welcome once again to all of our guests on this very special day. We are excited to have you here worshiping with us and celebrating the new births that are happening, that have taken place over the last 6 months to a year or so, as we dedicate the gifts of the Lord back to Him. What an exciting day. Please see your new April bulletin for all upcoming event details. There should be some available out on the information booth with a calendar as well, so that you know what's going on here at the POLR. Tomorrow night, a few things we'd like to highlight. Tomorrow night at 7 p.m., our Monday Night Life, our typical Monday night service tomorrow night. We call it Monday Night Life. We invite you to come back and be with us at 7 p.m. Great things happen on Monday night, and we're excited about what God is doing there. Also, Wednesday night prayer meeting, we call it War on the Floor. We believe that the Bible talks about and teaches us about spiritual warfare, and that is how we do. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, the Bible says, but we fight through prayer. And God is fighting with us and for us. And we join together every Wednesday night at 6:30 to pray and seek the face of the Lord. Also, Easter Sunday worship service. Very special time, a very special service coming up on April the 20th. We'll have one service at 10:30 a.m. that day. It's going to be just a great day. We'll have a special worship set, a special message. Our kids will have great things for them to do. Invitational cards are on your seats today. Please use them to invite your friends and family. Or if you're a guest here today, use them to put on your refrigerator so that you do not forget about our special Easter Sunday service. Also, thanks, a special thanks to all of you who participated in our POLR Beautification Day yesterday, our work day. The rain did not hamper us one bit. And when you pulled up this morning, hopefully you noticed the beautiful flower beds that are probably 95% weed-free. Thank you for those of you who participated in that, and the blessings of the Lord will be upon you for that. It is time to receive our Sunday morning tithing and offering, and what an honor and privilege it is to give to the Lord. If you could stand at this time, we have found that you can more readily and easily access your wallet and purse if you stand and stretch and reach around, and you can march as an act of worship as we give in the offering. Better if you're standing and stretch a little bit before we actually give the word to march. So God bless you for participating in this. God bless you for being faithful in giving of tithing and offering. And we have envelopes for you to put your money in if you would like to use those for missions offering, building fund commitment, love offering, and tithing. And we appreciate that. God bless you. If you would bow your heads right now, we're going to bless this offering. Father, I thank you so much for your spirit that we feel here today. Lord, you are just so gracious, and Lord, you allow us to live exceeding abundantly above what we could ask for or think. Lord, you provide for us in every way, shape, and form, and we give you glory and honor for that. And God, it is our privilege, and it is our duty, and it is our right, and it is our act of faith, Lord, to give back to you, to return to you the first fruits, and then to give above and beyond even that in offerings. I thank you for faithful people who do so. That's why we can have a church here today, where people can come and feel your presence like we do this morning. Bless every gift and giver this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would march from the back to the front and put your offering in the baskets, God bless you. thank you once again for being here. We are honored, all of our guests, that you chose to be with us today on this very special day. This is Baby Dedication Sunday, and we do this once, sometimes twice a year, depending on how many babies we have. And at this time, we have a very special video presentation set to music. So I would draw your attention to the screen behind me as we celebrate our new babies. God bless.
Climbs in my lap for a good night hug. He calls me dead and I call him bub. With his faded old pillow, a bear named Pooh, he snuggles up close and says, I wanna be like him. I tuck him in bed and I kiss him goodnight. Tripping over the toys as I turn out the light. I whisper a prayer that someday he'll see. He's got a father in God, cause he's seen Jesus in me. Lord, I wanna be just like you, cause he wants to be just like me. I wanna be a holy example for his innocent eyes to see. Help me be a living Bible, Lord, that my little boy can read. I wanna be just like you, cause he wants to be like me. Got to admit, I've got so far to go. Make so many mistakes, and I'm sure that you know. Sometimes it seems no matter how hard I try, with all the pressures in life, I just can't get it all right. But I'm trying so hard to learn from the best, being patient and kind, feel your tenderness. Cause I know that he learned from the things that he sees, and the Jesus he finds will be the Jesus in me. Lord, I wanna be just like you, cause he wants to be just like me. I wanna be a holy example for his innocent eyes to see. Help me be a living Bible, that my little boy can be. I wanna be just like you, cause he wants to be like me. Right now from where he stands, I may seem mighty tall, but it's only cause I'm learning from the best father of them all. Just like you, cause he wants to be like me. Thank you.
give them a hand. Let's give them a good hand. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord today. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Welcome to Baby Dedication Sunday. This is always a family-focused day where I deliver a message not only to dedicate babies but to remind us of all of our responsibilities that we have in parenting and being parents and families. And so I thank all of you extended family that are here today. Hope you enjoyed our worship service. If you don't have a regular place to attend church, we invite you back next Sunday to a wonderful time. And we do have ministries for all ages. And we do hope that above and beyond everything else today that you feel the breath of the Lord Jesus Christ blow upon your life. We hope today that when you leave this service, you hadn't just heard or seen a production of humanity, but that you felt the eternal spirit of the Almighty God as he comes down and touches you regardless of where you are in life. And so right now we're going to invite the presence of the Lord. Would you raise your hands and ask the Lord to minister to us through the word of the Lord? Shall we do that together? Let your voices out and let's ask the Lord for his blessings. Father, we pray the blessings of the Lord Jesus Christ will be upon us all. We open our minds, we open our hearts, we open our spirits to the word of the Lord. And may the seed of the word be deposited in open hearts and ready minds and spirits. And may we grow and be better people when we leave here in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen. I want to talk to you today about the greatest gifts. The greatest gifts. A child is said to be one of the greatest gifts. It has been a little part of her and a little part of him. And a lot of God-given uniqueness. It's always kind of neat to stand around the bassinet or the crib of a newborn and to hear the parents and the grandparents ooh and ah and try to figure out which one they look like. The greatest gift we can give our children is to be a parent that nurtures their spirits and their souls. The greatest gift is to prepare them for life here and the life that's after death. Today you may be a mother, a father, a sister, a brother, a grandparent, or mentor. But studies have shown that if just one person cares enough to nurture a child in their spirit and in their soul, it's often enough to make up for what is missing in their life. Parenting is said to be the most important job you'll ever have. It's more important than being a surgeon. It's more important than running the transport system. It's more important than being the president of the United States. The greatest thing in all the world is to be a parent. Just because we have the ability to bring children into this world doesn't mean that we will make the sacrifice needed to be actually a parent. Dr. James Dobson has written a book called Parenting is Not for Cowards. I am for all books of formal training on parenting. And if you haven't read this book, you need to buy it and put it in your library. Because if you have cowardly things, then we will not fulfill the obligation that the Lord Jesus Christ put upon us. However, I contend for a statement that I heard a man of God say many years ago. He said, the three greatest gifts that we can give our children to be passed on down through all generations of time is love, prayers, and scriptures. The greatest gift that we can pass down to our children, and it will sustain all times and governments and kingdoms, say it with me, say love, prayers, and scriptures. We live in a world where frantic parents cram time into busy schedules. And they wait and they weigh in into overextended budgets trying to get things that they really don't need. For birthday parties and Disney World trips and sports that go beyond their budget. But from one who deals with the most coming into this world and the exit of this world, I beg you as a man of God, I am there when children come into this world. And I'm there when people leave this world through death. I want to just tell us all today and remind us, don't neglect the greatest gift that God has ever given us, and that's our children. No matter what, keep your future generations walking in the righteous path of the Lord Jesus Christ through love, prayers, and scriptures. I understand you want to give them things that you didn't have when you were coming up, but there's one thing I want to give them that you've got today, and that's to know how to talk to God. That's to know how to love the word of the Lord. That's to know how to pray and call on God. Because when the government don't have the answer, God Almighty's got the answer. And when there's no love and money, there's love in the word and the power of God Almighty. I want to preach to you today, it's more important to give them love, prayers, and scriptures than it is to give them a trip to Disney World, teach them how to hunt or fish, do all that, but let's give them the word of the Lord God that liveth and abideth forever. Jesus, Joseph, and Mary. Almighty God could have come to this earth in any form he wanted. But he chose to be born and nurtured by parents. He chose to be born and nurtured by parents. In his cause, his mother was a very young teen. This young girl had a responsibility of nurturing and preparing Jesus Christ for the world that he would face. She wouldn't always get everything right, like we don't always get everything right. But she knew how to start and how to get the right things right. We don't have to know everything, parents. But we have to get the right things right. And that's love, prayers, and scriptures. We pick up the passage in St. Luke chapter 2, verse 21 from the New Living Translation. It says, 8 days later when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel even before he was conceived. Then it was time for their purification offering, as required by the law of Moses, after the birth of a child. So his parents took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Presenting him to the Lord is what they did. And this meant that they were committing to raise this child, baby Jesus, by the scriptures, by the law, by the word that had been given to Moses on the top of the mountain. It was a responsibility of the parents to understand to get the right things right. It wasn't up to them to get everything right, but it was up to them to get the right things right. And I hope you understand this morning the right things are in this book. The right things are in the teachings of this book. And it will never supersede this book. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word will never pass away. You can stand on this word. You can live by this word, and you can die by this word. You might get some things right, but we need to get the right things right. Would you clap your hands and give praise to the Almighty God? It was up to the parents, Mary and Joseph, to get the right things right. And so they had to take him, and they had to know the law. The first thing was they had to know the law. Then they had to obey the law. It wasn't up to baby Jesus on the eighth day to turn around and all of a sudden get a speaking voice and say, hey, mom and dad, won't y'all take me to the temple? Today it's time to get circumcised, and today it's time to get me purified. No 8-year-old child has the voice or the ability to talk at that age and say, mom and dad, it's time for y'all to do what y'all supposed to do. You know, I'm sure there's not a whole lot of pleasure in being circumcised on the eighth day. So if anything, the child wouldn't have said that. But it was up, not to the child, but it was up to the parent. It was a duty of the parents to know, and not only know the scripture, but to respect the law of the Lord. And if we've lost one thing that used to be in our courthouses, in our schools, we've lost it and we don't have it there anymore. But could I stir up a respect in this crowd today that you get a new appreciation and love for the Word of God? This book is just as dated as it was the day it was written, for it will never pass away. It's as current as it was the first day the words of the Lord were given to Moses. If you don't believe it, just find yourself in the Word, and you'll find out the answers ring true the same all through time. Then the law of the Lord said, teach them every day. He said, teach them when you're walking by the way. Teach them when you're eating at your mealtime. And can I just stop and say this? There's a little rule at my house that when we go to our table for dinner at night or we go to a restaurant, we leave all media in the car or on the chair. We're not allowed to take it to the table, because at the table we don't talk about work. At the table we talk about life. We talk about what did you do today, what happened in your life today. And I'm telling all of us today, let's unplug from this stuff that we don't need anyhow. It's not important how many people follow you on Twitter. It's not important how many people follow you on Facebook. It's not how many people you know that you really don't know, and you're texting them something that don't really mean anything. I tell you what means is, how did your child do in school today? The bumper sticker says, have you hugged a tree today? Have you hugged a horse today? Well, let me ask you, have you hugged your child today? Have you hugged your grandchild today? The law of the Lord says, teach them every day the right things. When you're eating, before you go to bed, and off to school and off to church. Dr. James Dobson, quote, I'll read to you now. He says, every day that goes by without spiritual training for your children is a day that can never be recaptured. Every day that goes by without scriptural training for your children is a day that can never be recaptured. Parents, we are living Bibles written in our hearts, the word of the Lord by the finger of God. And we all hear about delinquent children in our world, but we really don't have a delinquent children problem. The problem in 2014 is delinquent parents finding themselves and doing what makes them happy. You see, I'm the one that sits behind the desk to try to be a counselor that I hear way too often. I just want to go find myself. Well, I thought you found yourself when you came to the Lord Jesus Christ. Who are you going to go find this time? Oh, y'all getting a little quiet on me right now. It's all right. You're going to go find yourself. What you going to do? You're going to throw your morals away? You're going to throw your values away? If you're going to go find yourself, get this book out. Let's go find ourselves at an altar of prayer. Let's go rededicate ourselves to the Lord. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. If we want to find ourselves, let's find a new creation by having a renewing of our mind. Let's have the mind of Christ. Let's have the mind of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, let's praise the Lord and give him glory right now. My son is a school teacher, teaches in a town in North Louisiana. He teaches 8 classes a day. And several of his classes, and one in particular, the class that he teaches, is made up of mostly juvenile delinquents. He has 158 students that cycle out of his 8 classes in one day's time. And he told me when he first took the job 2 years ago that he went into the schoolroom, and he still practices to this day. He gets there every morning before school starts, and he takes the oil and he anoints every chair where every student will sit. And there's times that he has to write up delinquent reports and discipline reports on a child that has misbehaved. So writing up that report, he has to call the parent and has to let them know that there's a problem. And he said, Dad, the biggest problem I have is I really rarely find a parent. He said, when I do get someone on the phone, it's usually a single parent who leaves a child unattended most of the day and night alone by themselves. He said, but more than even a single parent, I may get an uncle or an aunt or grandmother or grandfather who may not even know where the child is most of the time. He told me the other day, he said, Dad, I got a just one report I had to write up. And he said, I got a parent on the phone, and the mother says, and I quote, I can't do nothing with that boy. He's just destined for trouble. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm just going to send him, call him by name, down to that delinquent home. He's a bad kid, and he will wind up in jail anyway, so I'm just going to throw him away down there to school, and whatever they can do with him, they can have him. However, on the flip side of that coin, he said the other day, he looked up. One of his students come into that class. He said, behind that boy come a big old man. He said, big old man walked up to him and said, I'm so-and-so, the second. And as you know, this is my son as part of your class, and he's the third. And I'll be sitting by him in class today, if that's all right with you, sir. Son says, sir, that's all right with me. He said he taught his class, and he gave the test out, the same test he had gave the day before. Said that boy that was sitting next to his father turned in the test, and he said he had time to grade it. He wanted to grade his, and he waited after the class was over, and the father stayed by his son, and Jathan took the test of the day before where he signed his name and turned it in and left it all blank. But the day that his father was there, he filled every blank in and aced the test. And Jathan said, sir, I just want to thank you for coming here today, because this is the most work this boy has done all year. He said, if you'll just take a little interest in him, you see what's down on the inside. Oh, don't look at your child like they're a nobody or in an accident. Don't treat them like they're just trash and rubbish. There's a king living on the inside of them. There's a governor living on the inside of them. There's a preacher. There's a mama. There's a daddy. There's a missionary. There's a Sunday school teacher. You got a king living on the inside of that child. I know in the 21st century, I know it's not easy to be a parent, but if we're committed to it, we'll reap the rewards later in life. God loves families. He's all about families. They're important to him. And he gives wisdom and strength to parents who seek him. That's what we're doing here today. We're trying to seek the Lord, because we want to get the right things right. Jesus Christ was born with a purpose and a mission to fulfill. It was up to Joseph and Mary to raise him with that mission in mind. They couldn't just raise baby Jesus any old kind of way. They had to raise him according to what the angel said and according to what his pedigree said. Just think about that with me. Likewise, we must not look at our children as pets or pawns or even pests. Yes, they're going to get on your last nerve sometime and jump up and down on it. My daddy promised me one time when I was just a little boy, he said, son, Saturday I'm taking you Western Alto and buy you your first shotgun. So on Monday morning I woke up, I said, Daddy, is this the day? Monday I come in from school, Dad, is this the day? Tuesday morning, Dad, is this today? Tuesday night, Dad, is this today? Is tomorrow? He said, son, if you don't shut up about worrying me about that shotgun, you ain't never going to get it. Did I shut up? I got up Wednesday saying, Dad, is this going to be the day? They're going to jump up and down on your last nerve. They're going to get cake everywhere. They're going to spill stuff everywhere. But stop and think about it. They got a mission you got to raise them with. They got a vision. What do you want your child to be? I've got designs for my children. I don't want them to be walking the streets and homeless. I want them to understand what the law of God says. Come on, let's give him some high praise right now. Ask yourself, parent. Ask yourself, grandfather, grandmother. Ask yourself, aunt and uncle, you that are here today. Do I know the mission for my children? Look at your child. Look at your child, Daniel. I've seen you look at her just then. Look at that little baby girl. What do you want her to grow up to be? It shouldn't be in the things that you can give to her that are only temporal, that will pass away. But the greatest gift that's been given to you, you can give the greatest gift, which is eternal, in her. Because we all are eternal creatures living in time. And this just is a precursor, a place to get ready for the hereafter. Jesus told the parable of two men who built identical houses, and one built on the rock and one built on the sand. One took the time to dig down to the bedrock and make sure he had a rock solid foundation, and the other just threw up a house. And when the storms of life came, and they will come to your family, disease will come, heartache will come, betrayal will come, death will even come. But it matters what we're built on. If we're built on the sands of time and the changings of our world, then when we need help and hope the most, is there hope in stocks? Is there hope in money? The only hope is, the apostle wrote to the church, if I had hope in this life only, I would be of all men most miserable. But I have a hope that is beyond this place. We got to have a rock solid foundation. And I want to read a poem that I heard many years ago when I was training for ministry in the first location that we were sent by our organization. I was just a kid of 21, and my wife was 20. And I heard this poem, and it's went with me for many years. It's called The Anvil of God's Word. Last eve, I paused beside the blacksmith's door, and I heard the anvil ring, the vesper chime. Then looking in, I saw upon the floor old hammers worn with beating years of time. How many anvils have you had, said I, to wear and batter all those hammers so? Just one, he said, with a twinkling of eye. The anvil wears a hammers out, you know. And so I thought, the anvil of God's word, for ages skeptic blows have beat upon. Yet though the noise of failing blows were heard, the anvil is unharmed and the hammers, they're gone. Daddy, teach your boy to fish. Mommy, teach your daughter how to put bows in her hair. Daddy, teach your boy how to hunt and to play ball and to work. Mommy, teach your daughter how to cook and to comfort. Parents, teach our children how to succeed in life. But when it comes time to die, and we all must go through that door, the gift of our kids and grandkids will cherish most is the knowledge of God, His Spirit, and His Word. At their death, what will you hope you've given your child? Whatever that is, put it in their everyday life. Don't leave one ingredient out because it matters. An alcoholic, and I'm closing. An alcoholic came to the Lord in a city and brought his young daughter. She too was born again and loved everything about church. She participated in youth events and brought her friends from school. When she started college, she served on the youth committee and was a powerhouse of a talent. A sweet young man from a broken home came to the Lord and found love and family. There started into marriage. They started their careers. They got married. They both continued to help and to lead the youth and inspired many to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Baby girl was born from that union of marriage. They dedicated her to the Lord, such as we're doing today. Even as a tiny thing, she loved everything about church. She loved Sunday school and Wednesday classes, and she loved the singing and worship. But as their business prospered and they grew, They began to move up in the world. The appetite for God in the church and ministry began to cool. First, they began to miss midweek services. Then they began to miss Sundays. We asked them about them recently, and the report was from our relatives, we hardly see them anymore. They're just too busy and they're too tired. They say they need their rest. And all the while, their 11-year-old girl does whatever it takes to find a ride to church. Oftentimes, she's got to call friends, and when she can't find friends, she calls grandma and grandpa. To the parents, they have more important things to do. They have to get up early to get the jump on their competition so the profit margin will grow, and they can pursue the lifestyle that is never satisfied by temporal things. Thank God for the grandparents who are committed and told Donna and I that we'll do whatever it takes to get our little granddaughter to church, no matter the price we have to pay. PLLR, when you're with your family in their dying moments, what really counts then? I know this is maybe throwing you a curve at the conclusion of a baby dedication message, but we need to stop and slow down and think a little bit today that these bodies that we have here are not made to live here forever. They're made to live in the kingdom of heaven forever. I want to ask you, whatever it is that you want to give your children and your grandchildren that will last forever, then live for it. Show them how to do it. Parents, Jesus said, sell whatever you have to do to pursue this great treasure, for it's eternal life, not made with hands in the heavens. Families, has Jesus taken a back seat on your priority list? Parents, has entertainment or sports or hobbies sucking up precious family time? If someone were to ask your child what is the most important to you, what would they answer? What do you hope they answer? I would hope they would answer about me. My dad showed me how to love Jesus first. Then he showed me how to love the family. Then he showed me how to love the church. I didn't get it all right with my kids, but I got the right things right. I'm not asking you to get everything right, but I'm asking you to get the right things right. I'm asking you to sit up and pay attention to what's going on around you. Monitor what they watch in an uninvited room that they say theirs, and you're paying the mortgage on it. If so, let's ask for strength and wisdom to make sure they know what the most important thing is. The three greatest gifts that we can give to them is what? Love, prayers, scriptures. Right now is a time for us all to reassess. Right now, I just want you where you're sitting before we change the order of dedication. Right where you sit, I just want you to lift your hands and just repent and ask the Lord to have mercy on us. Ask the Lord to forgive us, and let's ask God to let us be better parents and grandparents and caregivers. Can we do that right now? Every hand. Whether you're a guest or family, whatever you are, raise your hands. All of us can pray this prayer. Father, we repent of us neglecting at times the most important gift that you've ever given to us. As a preacher, as a man of God, I'm also a father, and I thank you, Lord, that I had that opportunity to bring two children in this world. Now I have five grandchildren, another one on the way, and I repent of times when I hadn't been everything I should have been. I ask your mercy, and I ask your love, and I ask your forgiveness, and I pray that you'd forgive my mind, my heart, my soul. And Lord, that I'd get the right things right, that I'd always point back to love, prayers, and scriptures. And I pray that all of us here, that you would anoint our eyes with eyesight, that we might see things as you want us to see. Not as the world seeth, but let us see as our Heavenly Father sees. And we ask our forgiveness in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you say amen? I'm going to ask Pastor Jason to come now, and we're going to call the families up, and we will begin our dedication.
If the mother and father of the child will come as we call them, those that are present today, come and join us here on the platform. We have a packet. Inside this packet is a Bible, a certificate of dedication, a card from the church family, and then a prayer cloth that's been prayed over by our ministerial team. I would like for the parents of Danielle, Elaine Jenkins to come. parents of Sawyer Riley Skluzacek to come. Parents of Jolena Irene Blackburn. The parents of Miles Edward Bonavillian, come. Pastor Marty, join your wife. The parents of Drew T.J. Miley, come. Parents of Mason Brody O'Hearn, come. The parents of Kyle Aiden Williams. And the parents of Emmett K. Warner.
Just sit there with us and be in a prayerful state at the end of the service. We're going to give a chance for the altar, but we're going to invite at the end of service when I get through with the dedication, after we pray the prayer of dedication. We're going to go through a couple of creeds and some vows, and then I will invite the grandparents and the extended family onto the platform to join your addition to your family, and we'll pray some more. Okay, parents, after I ask you this question, I would ask you to say I do. And what beautiful children we have, all the way from my right, all the way down. And I'm sure that they're wiggling, they're squirming, and that's okay. We don't expect them to be perfect. But aren't they lovely? Why don't y'all give all of them a good hand? Don't they look so good? Yeah. I think some of them's eating more than others. I'm sure, you know, I look like that. Well, I was bigger than that, okay? Okay, parents, do you present your child or your children before God in this act of solemn dedication? Say, I do. Okay, I'm going to ask the ministers that are going to help us today if you'll come and take your places. I'm going to ask you to hold your child, parent, and the ministry is going to lay hands on your child. If you out there would stretch your hands forward, and as the ministry, we're fixing to pray at this time, and pray the prayer dedication. Let's pray together, men of God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I lay my hands upon Miles Bonavillian. He comes from a long line of heritage of ministers and church workers and church planners and evangelists, Sunday school teachers. He comes from a long line of faithful people. And Lord, I dedicate him to you right now. As Jesus Christ, you gave us the example of going to the temple to be circumcised and to be purified. Right now, we pray this prayer of dedication upon Miles and upon all these children in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now, we take our hands off of this child and we dedicate him to you and to your service and to your will. Let not our will be imposed upon this child, but this child will have the call of God upon his life. That each of these children will have the call of God upon their life. That they will do whatever you've called them to do. You've got a design upon each of them. They are fearfully and wonderfully made. They're uniquely made. And Father, they are not an accident and they're not a mistake, but they're divinely made and brought into this world to fulfill the plan of God. And I pray an anointing of the Holy Spirit to be on their lives, that you would lead and guide them every day of their life. And I protect them, God. I pray you protect their minds from erroneous teachings, Lord, but they would hear the word of the Lord and they would hear from their parents' love, prayers, and scriptures. And they'd be in a tender church and they'd be involved in the work of the Lord. that they would let the light of Jesus Christ shine out of them, and they would be born again of water and spirit. They'd be infilled and infused with the power of the Holy Ghost. They'd be baptized in that saving name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they'd be a threat to the kingdom of hell. I pray that they would not curse the darkness of the world they live in, but they would turn the light on so others would follow after the Lord. We pray now to you and give all these children to you in dedication. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, would you clap your hands and give praise to the Lord right now as these children have been dedicated by prayer and love? Come on, let's give God praise right now. Let's give God praise. Let's give God praise. I don't remember my baby dedication, but I know I was dedicated. Because they told me I was, and they reminded me every day of my life. They'd ask me what I was going to be. Oh, I'm going to be a mechanic. No, you're going to be a preacher. Oh, I'm going to do this. No, you're going to be a man of God. And that's what I'm telling all these children. Every one of them's got a king inside of them. When they aggravate you, Brother Lane said, Selena, just look and say one day they're going to be leading worship like I do. You showed them how to lead worship on this platform. I watch your other two kids down there in worship service, and they're down here, their eyes is on you. So watch how you walk a little bit in this world. Let's all be a little bit more aware of what we're doing and what we're showing them. Hear ye, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. You know why the Jews believe that to this day? Because it was taught to them when they sat down by the table. It was taught to them when they walked by the way. Okay, parents, I want you to say after me, I want you to repeat. I got about a couple of paragraphs here. I know it's kind of long, but I want you to repeat together, okay? I pledge to consecrate myself as a parent to bring up my child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. I pledge to instruct my child in the teachings of Jesus Christ and in the practice of prayer for the development of Christ-like character in their life. I pledge to be the best and do the best of my ability to shape our home life by family devotion, godly conversation, and by my lifestyle so that our children will at the proper age most naturally embrace Jesus Christ. Everyone said amen. Okay, fathers, I want you to repeat after me. I want you to look at your child, fathers. If you're not holding them, grab the child. I want you to say, fathers, I want you, this is for you, okay? We're repeating. I pledge as a father of my children to make my relationship with my family paramount. I will try at all times to behave toward my children as my heavenly Father behaves in love to me. Okay, mother, hold your child. This is your pledge. Jolena looked so cute there. Got to hold her the other day at the house. She went to sleep in my arms. Don't she look gorgeous in that white? Okay, mothers, are you ready? See if y'all can say a bigger line than your husbands did. I pledge as a mother of my children that my relationship would be more than that of a supermom. But my relationship would not only to show my children how to open a box of cereal, but guide them to the open gates of their heart to God. Okay, church family, it's your turn, all right? I'm going to ask y'all to stand, everybody, if you would, please. I'm going to give you a charge. At the end of my statement, when I stop reading, I'm going to read the line. I'll read it all the way complete. And when I get done reading the line, I want you to say with me, with God's help, we will. Let's try it. With God's help. Say it again. Oh, that sounded like a mighty choir. We pledge this day to do all that we can to provide a place of instruction of God's word and passionate worship. We pledge to ensure that these children hear the whole counsel of God. We covenant together to set an example by our lifestyle to maintain a holy, godly atmosphere that will inspire all children to desire to live for God. And we pledge to respond as God leads us to pray for the salvation of these children and the children of the world. Let's give a hand praise to the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on, let's give a hand praise to the Lord. Let's thank God for our children. Your children are here and they're married today. Thank God for them children. You got grandchildren here today? Clap your hands and thank God for them. At this time, Sister Michelle and the singers are going to sing. I invite you, if you want to have a time of prayer at the altar, I invite the grandparents and the extended family to be on the platform. I'd like you to spend a little bit of time to pray with your family. We can kind of scatter around on the platform so they can all get here. But let us come up and let's pray. You'd like to pray, you're out there. If you want to be dismissed, that's your prerogative. Be here tomorrow night at 7, but come on the platform. If you're part of these children here, or if you want to come and pray and talk to the Lord, and we pray that you'd come and talk to the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If you want me to talk to your children, pray with your children.
This is my desire.
dismissed if you want to. Bless you in the name of the Lord.